Right, but Paul has a workflow where he has Debian in a completely separate branch that doesn't have upstream source in that branch.
Right.
Convince me this makes sense.
You're crazy.
Let's make it easier.
He also said he likes SVN build
patterns.
Yeah.
Like git log on the top directory, and don't worry about it, and like
this
you don't
stream
Python. And like and when you like
because of reasons. Raisins.
Is there a whole raisins?
And I have like a whole spiel, but I like
I will personally write dot git slash config alias for you to so log in that directory.
You never end up like even like when you have upstream artifacts, they can like get out of sync with the tarballs. Like if you did forget to pull and like the packaging changes and you build it and like ends up working, and then like
this didn't happen to us yesterday.
It didn't happen at all, did it? And
wait, actually, I don't understand.
Well, for me, I like
if you like forget to pull correctly, then you can end up with
if you
stuff
forget to do the merge from upstream back into your Debian branch. Then everything
well, you can do it later, but my problem is that
But then it doesn't like it's not correct.
Right. For me, I merge from upstream if the tarballs are uncontaminated. If I have to do Debian free software guidelines and repackage the tarball, I forget about the upstream history and I generate my tarballs from their upstream commit history. But then in my packaging Git repository, I commit just my clean tarballs, and then I go off that. So for me, I do both workflows.
So once you have generated the tarball, you commit it to pristine
branch? Yes, yeah, the ones that I generated myself. I commit those, and then my history only has like Debian packages, patches, and Debian free software guideline tarballs. One per commit with no upstream history because it has all the bad stuff.
I wanted to ask you if better tooling could solve your problem. And for instance, if we had a pre-receive hook that made sure that the upstream branch would push before the Debian branch and a Debian change log entry of 1.2 actually descended from a tag 1.2, that sort of thing.
That would make me a lot happier.
Okay.
That would make me a lot happier. Yeah.
Okay.
Because you can get those two halves out of sync.
I still think it's like innately gross, but it's still when I see it, I don't like it, but it's fine. I can live with it. I have to work in other teams that do it this way. This is not a problem.
Filter which tags and branches you pull.
Then you like look at the git tree and history, and it's like.
So,
so
what do you need to strip? Strip things out?
If I can't redistribute,
why don't you make those? No, I understand. When you do that,
yes.
Why didn't you make that those changes as a commit on a branch from the upstream?
I can't redistribute that file.
Yes.
That file is part of the Git history. I am distributing Git history on alias. I do not want to distribute that contaminated history.
That is a great answer.
Yes.
Yeah, but that's a non-solved answer for all packages, anything on that.
If it's not distributable in the archive, it shouldn't be.
If FTP master rejects that file,
yes.
Why should I store it on alias?
You should.
Yeah, but that's a
non-enforced
policy.
How about what you've got relates to what's upstream.
So whether you...
I would agree to use graph points, such that physically it's separate, but there is a link in history and metadata.
You're concerned about things that are not distributable, I suppose, non-free.
Yes,
right.
Non-distributable.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that seems like you can solve that with just like you have the.
There's a tool for that in Git that can remove a file.
Yeah, graph points.
Right.
Yeah,
but
you damage the history.
Filter branch.
So the same sort of thing you do when repacking a source in Debian rules, you do that to every single commit.
We are in string.
And you make a.
Where what?
Where string.
The rips make string to the end.
Oh, God.
You where?
I hope we should all tell you that.
Hey, York.
Hi.
And like none of the media team is here, so we couldn't tell.
Yeah, move the camera away.
There's no reason to turn it down. There's no reason to turn it down.
Are you
sure?
No, that's fine. It's fine. It's fine. Yeah.
It's fine. So you could do something. Again, I'm proposing tooling, and I think this is not terribly complicated tooling to write, where you say, I'm going to make my Debian history diverge from, like, commits on top of my non-Debian history that I can't distribute on Alioth, and the parents are there, but there are rewritten commits, so the parents don't actually exist on Alioth. And so you can clone it, you can actually interact with it, but some of the parents don't exist.
Well, I think there are 2 points. One is I'm quite sure it's a non-enforced policy right now, and I'm sure there are loads of undistributable stuff on Alioth. So there is no particular reason why the patent team should care and others not.
Okay.
That's one point. The other point, I think rebases are okay, and I'm doing rebases and non-pullable things on various of my repositories because mostly I know I'm alone pulling from them. And I think if you mail the maintainers list saying I've rebased for this or this reason, please make sure you have the new version, then I don't think it's that bad.
I mean, Git DPM, it in essence does rebase each time, but it keeps the history of each rebase due to merges, such that I can go back in time and see how the patch series was rebased on top of each upstream.
Thankfully,
that's the idea. And in that sense, I kind of like it, because you do want to see the clean rebase of what Debian is doing to a package, yet you do want to see the snapshots of that action.
Git DPM is an excellent example of this, but it's just worth thinking about this conceptually, that even if you are rebasing commits, if you have a different branch that has each of the results of the rebase as one of the parents, now you have a non-rebased history that includes this.
Yeah.
And that's what Git DPM does.
Yeah. We should get focused on the things we have to solve.
Yes.
So we're still not on the workflow. It seems that everybody is okay with using Prism tar.
Yes.
Yes.
I've been using tag-based generation of the ORIC file when I just follow the option git.
Okay.
Are you comfortable with that, or do you think I should? Whatever happens, just press
it on. Is the git tag signed?
Yes.
Do you verify the signature of that tag?
I do, and I have the signature. Sign signatures with upstream.
That's fine.
There was discussion in the previous room where we said we should be using pristine tar, even if we are generating our tar balls, just so that you know how the tar balls are generated, and you don't have to guess.
Well, I think the answer to
you don't need to guess because there's the debian/gbp.conf that tells you that you are using tags.
That's only the case where there aren't upstream tar balls.
Okay,
yes.
That for you. I prefer to use upstream git.
Yeah.
Okay, there's that case, so you will have to address it this way.
I mean, what if I
prefer to use upstream git rather than the table?
Yeah,
are you guys okay with it? Or
are they both identical?
No. Usually not.
No, because one point is that I'm going to use exec permission.
But what is it? The problem is that the git tag is signed, and you can compress it better. The tarball is often not signed.
Well, this is my question.
They should, shouldn't they?
Problem solved.
And they should make them identical to the history, shouldn't
they?
They
can also sign the tar to the upload IPI.
Yes.
But that's not my question. My question is it okay with you guys that I do like that, or do you prefer that I...
If the original tarballs are published, we should be using them if they are signed.
We should or we must?
No, I think that's current best practice.
That's current
I do have concerns about not using the upstream tarball if upstream is generating tarballs.
True.
I do because it's less efficient. You're going to spend more work.
But
I'm less concerned about the efficiency than I am about the discoverability of what the packaging is doing. If we're working on the same package, okay, it's a team package, and you haven't done it this tarball way, then I come in and I say, well, I haven't seen Thomas in a couple of weeks and I need to fix this thing, and I do what I think the team does, then I'm not going to know that. I mean, maybe if you specify everything in the readme.source.
The point is
that I will have to do that to do a readme.source because upstream do want me to document that I'm regenerating the tables and not choosing what they publish. Second thing is that, as I said, in the debian/gbp.conf, you can say, I'm using tags.
Yeah.
So these two ways you can know.
Yeah, but it's still something that is less discoverable.
Yeah.
It's a deviation from the norm. I'm not saying that it's not a good reason, I'm just saying I'm uncomfortable with it.
Yeah. And what is it for me, the problem is,
yeah.
For me, the problem is that a lot of times the tarball is different from the history, such that when you do the export, it can be different from the
tarball.
Which
is why I want to use Git, because usually it's cleaner.
It's not clear. The generated files are there for a reason.
I mean, I've seen things
yes,
that...
Yes, for PyPy, not for us. It's for PyPy.
That's what they release as tarball. That's what they intend as
yeah.
things for
that's,
the consumption.
That's as an upstream, if you're releasing to the Chi shop, your mental image of that release is that tarball.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You should make sure that those things actually built from source.
No.
Yeah,
no.
A lot of the time they don't.
Whatever is in the tarball,
yeah.
Sure.
Distributable. A lot of time the branch builds and the tarball on Chi shop does not.
But that's
don't care.
No, that, but that's true. And I've had a couple of cases like that, and I go back to the upstream and I say, you effed up your tarball.
I'll send you an email, Lex.
And that's a good thing, because it makes life better for
yeah.
other consumers of tarballs.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So it means that whether, no matter what, we just use PC tarball.
I think we're going to do
that.
Yeah.
I think we're never going to get to no matter what, because there might be an upstream.
I mean, if there are no tarballs published,
I think
stop.
Default.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. If there is a tarball, use tarball. If there are no tarballs published, then we use the tags or commits
yeah, yeah.
or PCS generated.
I have another
suggestion. Of course, there's little cases we have to rebuild tarballs because of non-free things
yeah.
or the 50 meg image
yeah.
in there.
Yeah.
This, or the audio file of
yeah.
how
we,
to pronounce the name of the project.
Yes.
But we have techniques in Debian
source
to do that tarball rebuilding.
Yes.
Which
well, and even a bit of pristine tar.
Yeah, which,
so it's the same 90-10 thing. 90% of the packages
yep.
you should be using upstream tarballs if they exist, and otherwise you should be generating tarballs out of the tags and checking those into pristine tar.
Yes, that's
we
correct.
And then we put it in pristine tar?
Yes.
Or,
yes.
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 But that doesn't mean you cannot use upstream's Git history
yes.
yeah. as upstream.
Right.
Either your pristine tarball will have a large diff with whatever was put in the tarball then.
Yeah.
Or you create another branch that is like upstream plus artifacts or upstream release artifacts, and you just create the diffs, and then you have something in Git that has that representation.
Yeah.
And I think it's more interesting to have upstream's Git repository than the only the tarball's history.
Mm-hmm.
Then you get the individual
yes.
changes.
Branch names. Anyone want to start with that?
Yes.
That's easy.
Debian/div.
Well, this is branch. We also have to talk about tag names. But for branch names, I mean, I don't know. I didn't have a lot of experience with it, but when I used not the default branch names, I thought it was a good idea at first, and then I kind of hated it. So then I renamed the branches to it's master, pristine tar, upstream.
Yeah, that sounds good.
What I do
yeah,
is
that's,
what
that's
I do
not
for
good
everything.
Enough.
Why? That's what I do.
Not good enough.
That's what I do for everything.
Yeah. See.
Okay.
There's one. I mean,
the boss.
Well,
you can be more explicit and use Debian instead of master.
Texas, you just solved the problem.
It's not less
easy. Pristine tar, upstream, and master. Yep.
So why is it not good enough?
I prefer Debian/sid, Ubuntu/trusty.
No, master is master. Master is the head of development.
Yeah.
Whatever that, wherever that goes.
Master is the branch for upstream. Never use master for us.
No, I like that opinion.
No, because like you will have a hell of a trouble if you rename and have config with upstream
branch.
Different
things.
Well, you will add.
It's origin/master.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
What I do is master for whatever is the head of the development, whether that goes to experimental SID or Ubuntu, whatever, and then you do suit-based names, like master-vz if you have to do stable.
So
update.
Your
yeah.
remotes
if
are origin/master, and your remote is Debian/master, and then your remote is Ubuntu/master.
Right. So do you,
yeah.
yes,
no.
your upstream, the project that is publishing the Python without any jacketing, is a remote named origin. Origin/master is their master. Us, we would be a remote named Debian.
Remote-a. Get remote-a.
We
are
why wouldn't you be origin?
Yeah, that's names. I mean,
or something.
Yeah.
Or we would
remote
be
names don't matter.
Yeah, what you have on alias is a repository with master that has the Debian packaging, upstream that is whatever is master's on the upstream side. That doesn't mean
and,
you cannot
and
say.
How do you do backports and
you create
and
a branch.
Yeah,
and what would be its name?
Wheezy backwards.
Just
backwards. Do we need master dash? Or just
whatever.
You can ask anyone what master means on a Debian packaging branch. You will have a different answer depending on who you ask, which is therefore why I think using master as a name is wrong.
Well, I turn the question differently. If you ask anyone what master means for a Git repository, they will always say it's the head of development.
Yep.
But who's
the
developer?
Who's the developer of your natural?
The repository. So
yeah.
Package grub/grub.git is not the same as upstream's grub.git. It's obviously has much of the same history, but these are two different repositories, and master means a different thing in each.
Okay,
and
so that's okay. You just said it. We have master, which means two different things.
Yeah,
no,
well, that's fine.
No.
Yeah,
is that a problem?
And it turns out that master means different things when you check out from an entirely different repository. This is not a surprise.
If I have a GitHub clone of your repository, I'm doing some work on it, my work will probably be on master, but it will be github.com/jeffd/repository/master, not github.com/u/master.
Right.
That's fine. That's how people tend to use Git, I think.
Yeah. When I created a fork of Torvald/Linux on GitHub, and it's Xnox/Linux, and then I have master branch, I don't think anybody believes that I actually released Linux Torvalds.
Yes.
And if you do, then please, you know, don't use that.
This despite the fact that GitHub, when you click fork,
yeah,
keep the description. And so I have a bunch of repos that say the official mirror of, and I'm like,
that's true.
There's totally another way then. I believe that we should make sense of our branches, and that we should have branches targeting the distribution that we are doing packaging for, which I think is best to have Debian C, Debian Wizzy, Debian JS.
Because is master pointing to experimental or to SID?
Yeah. Where does 99% of your developments go to?
Trump.
Get out!
Well, that's true.
Unstable.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, virtually all of the Debian Python team's development is
targeted
on stable. This is
we'll change in November.
Controversial.
So let's call it Debian SID then.
So you can. You will end up having to write that in a bunch of places, and it will be tedious and annoying.
that's
what
it is.
Annoying?
Just automatable.
Well, you have to go run vcs-star fields. Everybody has to know which thing to check out rather than.
We'll need to update the remote head of every single repository.
I think it's
certainly doable, but
it's swimming
against the stream.
I think the head should always point to SID.
And the easiest way to make sure that happens is to use the name master.
Yes.
You
can also automate the recapture.
Yeah, we could.
And we probably will, one way or another. There is no way in the Git protocol to change where remote head points.
Of course. Git protocol, maybe not, but using SSH.
Using SSH, yes, but I'm saying that for annoying reasons that relate to the Git protocol, there's a convenience factor in leaving remote head being master.
And I think if the problem is that upstream's master has to be upstream in our Git repository is an issue that's just either a tools or a documentation issue. We should not be blocked by that.
Mm.
I guess remote head is probably.
Okay, we'll call it master. Job's done.
Well, and then the question for you
is everyone.
And you start your own packaging team. Oh wait, you have.
Yeah.
Burn.
Okay.
Oh wait, we're streamed. I should be now.
It's all right. People have met you.
It's practice.
And we have to know which one we're talking about.
Let me find an example. You have released a new thing to SID, you're now doing some weird changes on the packaging, you push that to master for comments, and then someone says, well,
no, you push it to experimental.
No, you push that to master because it's the head of development.
And then
people say, well, that should probably go to experimental first.
Yeah.
So you cannot roll back the master branch
Well, what is it? I like how Digit deals with that. So it has a set of branches, which must match what is currently in the archive, such that if you get an NMU, you know that you take that branch, you commit an NMU, and you push it. And then the head of master development is a separate branch. Most of the time, it's the same commit as the Debian slash SID, but at times where you push something new which just hasn't been uploaded yet, you push it to master, but you don't update Debian slash SID. And then once you upload and tag it, then you match your master and your Debian slash SID matches.
Yeah.
But that adds an extra branch to maintain.
But that doesn't work all the time.
True.
You have Jesse, and you have a package in Jesse, it matches the Debian slash SID slash whatever. So the suit don't match.
Yeah.
What matches is the version all the time.
Well, yeah.
As far as, and tags, of course, as far as Debian slash SID, Debian slash SID go, just watch out for impetus mismatches. Like, I think GitDPM still has probably, if you end up using that, it still has some problems with master style branch names that have slashes in them. So
oh, God.
There's some, I think it produces, it works, but it produces something that is very unintuitive.
Yeah, there's an assumption that slash separates the remote from the branch's name, which is not true,
but
it's a general assumption.
I think you end up with upstream-debian slash SID or something.
God.
Is that why they don't use slashes in the tag names, whereas...
tag names still have slashes in them.
Tag names are fine.
Branches, I think, are strange.
Yeah.
I forget the exact constraints.
I wasn't sure when you just said Debian slash Debian slash SID, whether you meant remote Debian branch SID or branch Debian slash SID.
I meant branch Debian slash SID.
That is the obvious confusion when you use a slash branch.
So I would suggest dash.
Yeah.
Not time constraint.
Either master dash or just
Weezy. You're well over time.
We've already had an hour next door.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. Literally bike shed. Wait, so. Green.
Make me a free branch. Bike shed.
What's that?
Yes! Oh, yes! Yes! No, that's green!
So we have two choices here. Either master dash bike shed or just Weezy.
Yeah.
I suggest master dash Weezy. For when you do a stable update.
When you I prefer not having master as a as an element, but
that was a strongman on the proposal, so
strange, but sure.
Either A or
I'm
B.
Not actually
I was proposing D,
so whatever.
Yeah, just do Wheezy, I think it's better.
Yeah.
Just Wheezy, yeah. No master.
I'm just proposing things to have a
and we
proposal
have a
table
stable guarantee that the name suits are
and
unique.
Yes.
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 On both sides.
Sorry.
Tag names, do we
need to
talk? Yes, we do.
The Ubuntu guys are interested in that.
Yes.
What's wrong with just using what depmit minus r produces?
GitDPM and git build package use different tag names.
GitDPM can have, you can ignore it.
Sorry, you can
ignore it.
So I use GitDPM for everything.
Thomas, I think that's a wrong
tag naming
discussion.
So what is the tag name that dep changes?
Well, dep commit minus r produces Debian slash the
version number.
Version number
without
f box mangled
well
to fit.
Yeah.
Yes.
Without f
box. We want to do the default with
Pristin
tar then. Is it?
Yes.
Yes.
That's
yes.
What you guys want.
Well, you shouldn't really not have multiple branches for upstream. Unless.
Of course, first, how do you do for following with Weezy and
yeah, well,
you have
so
only one history.
What if you have a stable release branch?
So for multiple upstream branches, you obviously have to evolve the history present. You don't necessarily have to have a ref for a push ref for all of them all the time. So the side of like the approach it takes is to stick the SHA of the SHA one stream for that branch in Debian slash dot git dpm along with some other stuff, and that means you can always reconstruct the upstream when you need
okay.
it.
So no other.
Well,
just one branch.
Yeah, just one branch.
No, it doesn't work because in the previous hour we decided that we have the full history. So if you have the full history, your Debian branch has as history the whatever version you're basing on.
Okay.
You have the full history, but there's no reason you have to have refs for all for the
you
upstream.
You don't need
bit,
an upstream ref and a branch
right.
in alias. The fact that it's part of your history.
As long as you
okay, yeah, the objects are on alias, but not necessarily behind a branch.
Yeah, yeah, they don't have a branch
so
name associated.
I have a dumb question. Why do we need an upstream branch at all in that case?
Just
so
upstream tags.
Just keep upstream tags.
You
keep it in,
yeah.
in the Debian history.
I
somewhere.
Mean, if you're, it depends on what to. I don't know what GPPQ uses.
Right.
DPM is constructed locally with Git DPM prepare. There's no need. I tend to push it anyway, just because it's easier. But you don't have to. I have no idea what the other tools use.
Well, and the fact that you have a branch for things like upstream is quite common, so it's an expectation. Be able to like git log the slash upstream.
Yeah, I think that makes sense for the case where there's an obvious single branch for upstream, and in the case we're talking about where experimental is using a different upstream branch, or stable is using a different upstream branch, or whatever it is, then it's not clear what should be the upstream.
Well, there are some
as
you can always
as dep commit generate as. Dep commit generate.
Dep commit does that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But type it out that we base what dep commit does instead of actually specifying.
One word.
Dep commit dash r. It finalizes your change log, it commits it, and it generates a sign tag which is suitable for Git if you have colons or weird things in it. And then you just push. And
does it sign the tag?
Yes. It, by default, it asks you to sign. And what is it? And depcommit works with Git, Bazaar, Mercurial, SVN. It works with anything.
You wouldn't do that after upload.
Huh?
You wouldn't do that after.
Yeah, exactly.
Upload,
that, should, that must be before.
Well, it is
yeah.
before, yes. Because, yeah.
Because apparently,
minus R gives you the upload commit.
Well,
come on. For Debian tags before upload.
Does
before
anything,
upload and
the
push.
Match the upload. It doesn't really matter whether
before or after, does it matter?
Corresponding to,
yes.
Corresponding to
yeah.
upload.
Yeah, right.
Corresponding.
Does anybody know if it's possible to get Git push to use dash dash follow tags automatically?
Yes, there is a config option in 2.0.
Right.
So the answer is currently no.
What is dash dash follow tags?
Follow tags is push all of the tags that are referenced from something else, that refer to something else that is pushed.
So
that is
yeah.
in the target.
No,
it's what you actually want.
That's
to
all the that should be
really
helpful.
Yes,
yeah.
yes.
Yeah.
it should
yeah.
be
that's
the
slick,
list.
Yeah.
So in the sense of, if anything is new, then push the DAC course.
Well,
if
there are any tags that refer to objects which exist in the thing that you're pushing to, in the remote,
so
then
push
those tags as well.
Yeah, because if
sure.
you do git push tags dash dash all, it will push
yeah.
all tags that you have, which may be completely random crap which you've tagged for yourself and
yes.
shouldn't be public.
Right.
Dash dash follow, if you push master, and the tags that are reachable between now and then in master, all of those tags will be followed.
It's not the default because it's in some workflows you might want to
not
tag things locally, like this is where I started this kind of thing. But,
I think for the workflow there is still one thing we didn't decide on. So we, as I understand, we can use git build package, git dpm, or git qp, right?
GBPPQ.
Okay.
That's git.
So
git
build package. If we use
yes.
the,
Sorry,
the on the first and the second option, if you use one or the other, it doesn't matter. At the end, it's just git build package.
Yes.
The question is, do we want the third one or not?
Isn't that a question whether we have to specify a helper tool or we can leave it up to the individual maintainers? And I suspect that we can't. The latest things I've seen on the mailing list are that we can't because they're incompatible. So we can't use git dpm and git build package pq on the same package.
One leaves patches, dpm leaves patches applied in the tree without dockets. DPQ don't use quilt, but it uses it leaves the patches applied. GPPQ leaves the patches unapplied, and also I
think it requires pushing a separate branch that has patches in it.
They're not only incompatible, they also use some totally different paradigms, which makes it even harder when you just land a new package. So,
I suggest
we should set them on one.
Yeah.
I have a dumb question. Can we solve this with tooling? Can we automatically convert one to the other?
Can we? What?
Can you automatically convert
one? The answer is of course yes, because the common format is
which is in use.
Well, the answer is yes, because we ultimately convert to 3.0/quilt
form the tree,
which is the standard.
Have certain
files
in it.
Generates
and the other one expects the those files are not just done.
But I mean, they both generate perfectly valid 3.0 quilt source package. They have different representations in it of that.
The tree itself is different.
Can you filter branch one into the other? Like, is it possible for people who want to use...
Don't say filter branch, because it's destroying history.
I have no idea.
If I want to use... If the team wants to use GDPQ as the canonical representation, and I want to use GitDPM...
I've never used PQ, so...
Is there a non-painful way for me to make that happen?
Who has used PQ?
Almost no one has used either.
Apparently. I tried them both. And I've also used DPM, just that on that one package, the six package that Colin maintains. I felt more comfortable with Git DPM, but I can't say that I have a lot of data points on that.
In that case, like, because everybody never tried except you, then we are all in case one and two. It won't bother us.
There's still the simple, just have a Git history with the Debian/patches manual management, and then you just do your quilt thing.
No, we don't
want
that.
Which exists, but it's a worst of all worlds.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean,
but
my,
we suggest
we
just
if people don't have enough data yet, then I don't see why you need to decide this now.
Yeah, true.
So I think that's a great strategy, but also
you do
along
have
with
to figure out what to do with converting.
Also along with that is that we should not do a mass migration until we do decide on one or the other. And I'd like for there to be, once that decision is made, even if it's a painful way, to convert A to B.
Is there any way to import a Debian patches quilt repository into either of these?
You can certainly import into Git DPM. It doesn't import the full history, but it will take the current state and turn it into a series of commits against upstream merged into master.
So we could import the current important releases from snapshot with quilt series and later switch to a helper.
And
what
would have the other one?
How are we converting history?
I have no experience.
Those were dead. There's like
that
a
was
whole bunch of tools.
Are you keeping SVM history or are you just importing DSC as it is?
What would you
the
decide?
The tentative plan was to import DSCs of old stable and stable and nothing. Don't go back to snapshot. If anyone cares, they can use Git replace.
Wait. So just one for old stable?
DSC for old stable and SID.
So just three commits. Three commits.
There is a tool which
goes through everything
else. Well, because if it's just three commits, we can generate the whole thing for Git DPM, the whole thing for DQ, and tell people, here is a sample, two repositories, go play around with it, and within 2 weeks tell us which one you prefer.
It's not a bad approach for it.
And if it's just three commits, then we can convert it using either of the tool, and everybody will have package that they know to play around with.
For that sort of thing, you really only need to convert current state for something that has a few patches.
Yeah. Packages without patches, they don't care, do they?
Well, yes, but few, it's better than having 110 patches.
Let's
just use this painful. And the source format is one packages.
Sorry?
And the source format one packages.
Die a fiery death.
Die what, sorry, death?
A fiery death.
It's a tool that builds on top of Git build package.
You should write a role in.
But that's sort of the same
advice.
So are we saying doing a mass migration into both, or just opportunistically a
few
samples?
Well,
like 10 in both.
Realistically, if we want to have some results, we got to set up a deadline. At which point we decide which one we want to use, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how much time do we give
5th of November is a good day, Tepper.
That's 2 months is reasonable.
Well, that's actually a good data point. Maybe we should do that for experimental after everything that was. Because the important work now is making sure what we want is easy. So we might have some preparation work and do that after the freeze and prepare that colony after the freeze is done.
I think that's a good idea.
Because otherwise we'll rush and have half of the things within Jesse. And
The fun bugs to solve.
We should be fixing our sea bugs.
You're making the point that we shouldn't migrate before the freeze?
That doesn't mean we don't prepare the migration. I think we should prepare
and experiment,
but not change anything on the SVN in time for Jesse, because the energy should go into Jesse and not into
No question.
So packages uploaded to SID before the freeze should still be in the SVN.
Yes.
This means that if you modify a package after the freeze, you have to change the ECS headers?
That's a problem of how source packages are currently. I mean, how packages metadata is per suite and is uploaded to the archive. That means when you want to check out an old stable package, someone should have made sure the repository is still there.
I have a slight refinement maybe to the proposal, which is that I guess I could say, and I don't know if this is a good idea, but that you could opportunistically, if you were interested in trying one out, you would opportunistically convert it to Git and just maintain it in Git using one of the two helpers, one of the two regimes, and essentially ignore subversion from then on.
Yep.
If the regime that you chose is not the one that we end up with, then we have to convert that particular package. But we're not going to do a mass migration until after the freeze is over. And I think that allows people to experiment, but not have to worry, oh my gosh, I've uploaded from the Git repository, but now I have to also keep the Subversion repository.
Well, if you do upload from Git repository, change the VCS.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So
make sure it's accurate.
Yep.
I believe that we will have a lot of activity in our VCS after the release. And I think probably the freeze time is the one to do the migration.
Yeah. I'm just saying that from now until then, I don't want to have to keep Git and Subversion.
Do we agree that so we keep the VM into the freeze and then the migration happens during the freeze? Is that, do we all agree on that?
Sorry, say that again.
We don't change anything until the 5th of November, and then after the freeze, we can start the migration. Do you agree on that?
The mass migration.
Yes.
I'm saying that until before the mass migration, you can pick a package. Because I think that if you're going to say I really want to experiment with Git DPM, I'm going to pick a package that I'm working on a lot, and I'm just going to do the migration. I'm going to learn how to do the migration to Git. I'm going to figure it out. I'm going to learn all the pain points. But once I've done that, I'm just going to live in the Git world. And I'm not going to deal with. I'm going to update the VCS headers, and I'm not going to deal with Subversion.
Can you still continue to use Git SVN?
Yes, because then it just uses SVN behind the scenes.
So
you could do it.
So your proposal is that from now until the freeze, you can use either SVN or Git, as long as either using existing SVN workflow or you use some Git workflow that goes by those constraints that we have decided on, but is free to pick other stuff that we haven't yet decided on.
Yeah, and then
on.
You
but
also
try not
accept
to do too many packages.
Sure.
Yeah.
Don't go around converting everything just because you like it, but if you would like to experiment, you're welcome to. We consider it team maintained, you can upload it to SID, you can get it into Jesse.
Yeah. And be ready to, if you have to cope with a rebase later on.
Possibly you will rebase, because you would rebase in SVN anyway, you would do a new technology.
I'm even cool with saying, pick one of each. In other words, if you want to go to switch to Git, pick one and do Git GDP, and do one Git DPM, and don't convert anything else. Just pick one and do both and see what you think. And absolutely, let us know. Email, mailing list.
So when do we decide then?
Time
frame?
December 1.
Yeah.
December 1 sounds a good
ball. November 6.
Leave a few minutes for discussion.
Like like shedding.
No, no, the discussion should already happen before. I mean, before, and we should settle.
Yeah, 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 we need that deadline,
yeah,
so that we
fine.
Make the
I
decision
can
beforehand.
The numbers at four.
Maybe a few of us can have a shot at doing some conversion stuff during dinner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll
do that.
I'll do it.
Mm-hmm. So,
sure.
Would you say on December 1st?
November 6th is out.
That's what, it's end of August, so.
That's 4 months.
2 months. September, October.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a little more than 2 months. Is that enough time
to
experiment?
It will need one or two very motivated monkeys to do that anyway. So, unless someone volunteers to be that monkey, it will not happen then.
Yes, right.
So, November 6th is a decision deadline, not a migration.
Yeah.
And nobody's planning on getting up, warning November 6th, migrating everything by midnight.
If we we can do it.
Yeah, I'm not stopping anyone from doing it.
Look, anybody who wants to do the migration, you can come over to my house and feed you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Where are you?
I'm in D.C.
Oh, okay.
Well,
in Maryland,
place.
But close enough.
I would go
to bed. Yeah, I would. Wait a second. I must caveat that. I haven't checked with my wife.
So now you're trying to get out of it.
Yeah, no.
Everything is.
It's on
the
right
side.
We can edit it.
It's probably
going to
end up in there.
Yeah.
I live out of a hotel, actually.
Awesome.
Go team.
Yeah.
Okay, who will email Bliss this summary?
Yeah, good question.
I mean, in the absence of anyone else, I can, but I haven't really done any puzzle work in my life.
Everyone else is doing as good as.
I don't
know if you know Ben.
Thanks,
Stefano. Yeah,
for the IRC.
Okay, if you actually accept that, then we're done here. You have to say yes before we can leave.
I'm prepared to have a shot at it, but I was going to have a shot at it anyway.
Okay,
okay, cool. Well,
that's not a commitment to do it.
Well, you know, there's a lot of hacking time here, so
yeah.
I'd love to sit down.
Yeah,
oh,
like
we can try to do a few conversions.
There's a lot of things to do as well.
Good.
All right.
I learned a lot about Git from this conversation.
Yeah.
Oh, wasn't that kind of the point?
Yes, so.
Yeah.
There's so many fascinating things about Git.
There are.
That's my one.
Well, fascinating and stomach turning.
The fascinating ones are my one.
Yeah.
Honestly, someone, you know,
I want to press
you know what I'd be excited about doing? Writing a tool that automatically takes new uploads to the cheese shop, turns them into pristine tar branches.
Yeah.
And so there's just cheeseshop.debian.net, which has a Git repository of everything on
the
cheeseshop.
Yeah.
Unpackaged, but just.
Wait, actually, I could just auto stdebit.
Do it, man. Do it.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
There should be apt.gshop.debian.net. No RGs provided.
Do it.
I don't think we can
for all your untrusted code repository needs.
Hey, Docker.
Right.
Fine.
So, don't run it as root, though.
Yeah.
Well, root is the Docker.
Fun.
Irish.